This video is about a forgotten blues musician, one who influenced music that you definitely know today. He had an impact on artists like Eric Clapton and the Rolling Stones, and yet you may never have heard his music. When you think of the blues, North Carolina probably isn't the place that comes to mind. You're more likely thinking about the Mississippi Delta, Memphis, or Chicago. People like Robert Johnson, Muddy Waters, or Howlin' Wolf. But there was an important and influential blues scene here in the early half of the 20th century. It was a music known as the Piedmont Blues. One of the most successful blues artists before World War II was born Fulton Allen in Wadesboro, North Carolina. Although no one knows for sure exactly when, most sources seem to indicate it was sometime between 1904 and 1908. His mother died when he was young, and Allen moved with his father to Rockingham. Young Fulton began playing guitar as a boy, adopting the popular frailing style of picking that was common in that part of North Carolina at the time. In 1926, he married a 14-year-old, Cora Martin, when he was only about 18 himself. The following year, he began having trouble with his eyesight. A doctor in Charlotte told him he had ulcers behind his eyes, and that they were probably caused by a form of snow blindness. Turns out that diagnosis was incorrect. Years later, another doctor would determine it was actually a form of neonatal conjunctivitis, an infection from birth. Fulton Allen moved with his young wife to Winston-Salem, where he found work in a coal yard. Before long, he lost his eyesight completely and could no longer work there. He turned to his music, studying the recordings of Blind Blake and developing his picking style. He played around the tobacco warehouses of Winston-Salem and Danville, Virginia briefly before settling in Durham in 1928. Allen became a familiar fixture in the Haytie community and on Pettigrew Street and the streets of downtown Durham, where he would play around tobacco buildings where workers would enjoy his tunes. His guitar playing was a ragtime version of the blues, not like the straight-ahead blues that was coming out of western states. Allen sang what were known as Hokum songs, which were amazingly dirty and full of double entendre.
What's that smell like, peach, mom? Do they really want to know? What's that smell like, peach, baby? Do they really want to know? Smell like pudding and it ain't on pie. Same thing that you know you have to buy. What's that smell like, peach? Do they really want to know? I mean,
dirty little ditties like this were popular among the workers downtown. He was gathering a local following and attracting other musicians to his side. This group included the guitar and washboard player George Washington, as well as the Reverend Blind Gary Davis, who became a sort of mentor to Allen, and who had already established a following of his own. Rounding out this little blues circle was a young harmonica player, Sonny Terry, who would also find his own fame. In 1935, a record store manager and talent scout, James Baxter Long, heard Allen playing and knew there was something special here. And in July of that year, he brought Allen, Gary Davis, and George Washington to New York City to do a series of recordings for ARC, the American Recording Company. One of their first recordings was Rag Mama Rag.
Said I'm going uptown, had my hand, looking for a woman, ain't got no man. This way be looking for a needle in the sand, looking for a woman, ain't got no man, alright.
Fulton Allen wasn't exactly a name that would sell records, so it was decided that Allen would become Blind Boy instead. George Washington, who was a light-skinned black man, was known as Red, which was a common nickname back then, and being from Durham, he took on the nickname Bull City Red. In 1936, Long brought Allen, now known as Blind Boy Fuller, back to New York. This time he was accompanied by Bull City Red and Floyd Council, who now may be best known as the Floyd, whose name was adopted by the British psych rock band Pink Floyd. In 1937, Blind Boy Fuller signed on with Decca Records. Blind Boy Fuller was your quintessential blues man. He was known to dress in smart suits and was said to be an attractive man, popular with the ladies. He was a natural guitar picker, and his playing was admired by many. He was also authentic. He lived the life he sang about. And that meant breakups and dust-ups, debauchery, drinking, living hungry. His ragtime blues style wasn't original, but Blind Boy was one of the best at it. He also carried a .38 pistol in his pocket and was known to sometimes have a temper. 1938 brought him legal trouble. After an argument with Long, he reportedly waved the pistol at him, and in another altercation with his wife, he drew the gun and shot her in the leg. Neither Long nor Mrs. Allen testified against him, and he was released after a relatively short stint in jail. He would record more songs in South Carolina and Memphis, and then finally record his last two sessions in New York in 1940. By this time, Fuller's health was failing. He was suffering kidney damage from too much drinking and undergoing treatment for urethra blockage that may have been caused by sexually transmitted disease. Despite the fact that he was one of the top-selling blues artists from the pre-World War II era, he didn't receive much of that money, much like many other artists of that time and skin color. And with treatments and home visits from the doctor, he was struggling financially. Blind Boy Fuller died in February of 1941 in Durham.
He's gone. Blind Boy Fuller's gone away.
Though his short professional career only lasted about 5 years, Fuller had recorded over 120 sides in that time. His music, along with the music of other American bluesmen, would go on to influence and be copied by British rock and rollers like the Rolling Stones, who even named their 1970 live album after a Fuller tune. A lot of times, the British musicians would just copy the black musicians from America, and you can hear this when you compare Blind Boy's Untrue Blues and Cream's 1967 Take It Back.
I'll give you my money. What more can I do? You're the good little girl. Lord, but you won't be true.
Take it back. Take it back. Take that thing right out of here. Right away. Far away. Take that thing right out of here.
Now that the city is trying to preserve more of its heritage from the late 1800s and 20th century, after building the Durham Freeway right through the African-American populated Hayti district, it could do more. Currently, there is only this marker commemorating Blind Boy and Blind Gary Davis. And there's a solitary plaque along the American Tobacco Trail, which stands near Allen's final resting place, a gravesite that's now on private property. Blind Boy Fuller's music is certainly from another time. It may seem dated, but it is catchy, and somehow it does still resonate today. What do you think of Blind Boy Fuller's music and legacy? How should the city of Durham remember him? I'd love to see your posts in the comments below. And if you like learning about musicians from North Carolina and other great places and people, hit that like button and subscribe. Thanks for stopping by.